Bien, okay. Hola, bueno, quiero agradecerles sinceramente por esta oportunidad para poder compartir unas ideas filosóficas. Es un honor estar aquí, especialmente siendo un latino que vive en los Estados Unidos. México es un país que significa mucho para nosotros, por muchas razones. Y me gustaría más que todo poder dar una charla de filosofía en español aquí en UNAM. Pero eso no va a ser posible hoy día. yo nací en el Perú y migré a los Estados Unidos con mi mamá cuando tenía 9 años. Y las circunstancias fueron muy difíciles para hacer desarrollando el español, pero aún tengo esperanza que en el futuro pueda ser. Entonces va a ser en inglés. When I was in college, I became interested in the question of how math and logic was able to extend our knowledge. So it seemed magical to me, and it still seems magical to me, how you can learn things about the world through your senses, start with some premises that are observational, then you apply math and logic in your armchair, just sitting in your room, and out you get some new belief about the world that can be tested. So that seemed amazing to me, still seems amazing to me. And not only that, but the sort of a priori guarantee that you get through math and logic, it's not just that it makes the conclusion probable, but it makes it 100% guaranteed, right? So that's really an amazing thing. So this is project is kind of trying to sort of get at a partial explanation of how that's possible. So so let's consider just a very simple inference, modus ponens. And so this is a valid inference. And you're told that the conclusion is guaranteed by the premises. But if you're a philosopher, you probably ask yourself this question. Well, it's not just that the conclusion is guaranteed by the premises. There are also these other assumptions in the background, right? So there's like that modus ponens is a valid rule of inference. Isn't that an assumption? And here's another assumption, that these two occurrences of P mean the same thing, or they refer to the same thing, or something like that. They're coordinated in some way, and that these two are coordinated as well. So these are, I think, like some background assumptions. They're not that the fact that modus ponens is a valid rule of inference, and the fact that these are coordinated are not like extra premises in the argument, but they're somehow nonetheless built into the understanding of the inference. So that's obscure to me what it means to say it's built into the understanding. So I'm kind of trying to figure out what that means. Okay, so what bothered me about logic and in formal semantics is, so I'm going to talk about this coordination bit. So how these two are coordinated and how these two are coordinated. So that's the notion of coordination, or de jure coreference, or linking. So I'm going to be using these notions interchangeably. Okay, let's spell it. Linking. And one thing that, if you notice, so if you think this notion is important, coordination or linking, it's actually not, if you look at the formal, semantics formal languages and semantics for natural languages, it's never built in as an explicit requirement on the language. It's always something that's kind of like, it's like it happens, but it happens sort of flows out of other things that are made explicit in the semantics. So that always kind of bothered me, that the coordination was never, so in the semantics you never say, okay, these are coordinated, right? So in the semantics of formal languages, you never say that these are coordinated. It's not part of semantics, we explicitly say it. So it always kind of bothered me that it's never said. But anyway, so that was kind of something is always in the back of my mind. That some coordination story would have to be added to theory of meaning. Okay, so fast forward to graduate school. So in graduate school, I got really into direct reference theory, which is, for proper names, is the idea that the meaning of a name is just its reference. So that means that coreferential expressions like Hesperus and Phosphorus are going to actually mean the same thing. And of course, there are a lot of challenges to that theory, but it seemed very attractive to me. But also, I was always thought also, connecting up to the coordination thing, that Hesperus is Hesperus, although Hesperus and Phosphorus are referred to the same thing, because they're both names for the planet Venus. And so according to direct reference theory, these two sentences should mean the same thing, because Hesperus and Phosphorus mean the same thing. I always felt like, well, but there's an important difference here, because these two guys are coordinated and these two guys are not coordinated. And so it's kind of like in this situation. And so I thought that was something that should be considered in semantic theory. That's something that direct reference theorists should think about. But I never knew, I was just a graduate student, so I didn't know how to make this linking into, how to build that into the meaning, into the semantics. There's a difference between these two sentences, of course, but I don't know how to say that that's like a difference in meaning, which is what you want to solve the various puzzles concerning direct reference. And then, so I was in grad school, 2006, Kit Fine, during that time, wrote he gave a series of lectures, John Locke lectures, at Oxford University, and in those lectures, so I got a hold of those lectures, they were online, and I read them over the summer, and in those lectures, he was able to say, look, there is a difference between these are coordinated, and I'm going to tell you how it matters to meaning. So he solved the problem for me. So he was like, I read this and I couldn't believe like what I was hearing. It was very exciting for me. I remember spending the whole summer at a Starbucks, just reading over the lectures and just seeing how everything just kind of just fell together and made a lot of sense. It was a very exciting time for me. So I ended up doing a dissertation on this, and luckily I had him in my committee. So, okay. So this is, I'm going to say now a little bit about what I'm going to do for the rest of the talk. So, the first thing I want to do is say how this notion of coordination or direct reference or linking is really pervasive in everywhere, first of all, and it's also a very important notion. And then I want to give you sort of the classic Frege-ian solution. So using Frege-ian sentences it's a solution, it's an explanation of why there's linking and why there's coordination. So there's Frege solution. And then I want to talk about this other solution, which is a relationist solution, which is the one that Kit Fine endorses. And then another relationist solution, which is the one that I endorse and I've written about. And I want to say how the relationist solutions, mine and Kit Fine and my solution, is because there's a problem with that solution. In fact, Frege's solution is actually really quite elegant. And I want to sort of like make the point that the Frege-ian solution, which appeals to Frege-ian senses, or actually it could be done with mental files, gives you like really, really nice explanation of linking. But then I want to end by saying how, okay, fine, let's go with the Frege-ian solution. Once you start thinking more about how senses work in detail, you'll see how you're going to need linking and coordination anyway. So even if you accept Frege-ian senses, even if you accept mental files, you need to add coordination in your semantics to give you the right results. So this is an interesting result because this relationism that Kit finds linking stuff, it was motivated by this idea. So once you accept the right reference, once you forget about Frege, once you recognize that Frege was wrong, then you go with direct reference, and now you see we have a problem. So this linking thing comes in and solves the problem. And so what I want to say is, like, no, even if, forget about direct reference, even if Frege was right to start with, he still needs a notion of linking and coordination. So this whole idea that this coordination linking thing depends on direct references, I think might not be quite right. So let me start off with just saying, kind of introducing the notion of coordination, like make it be a little bit clearer about this. This is where I start from the in the handout. So if you just look at 1 and 2, Hesperus is further from the sun than Mercury, but Hesperus is brighter, versus 2, Hesperus is phosphorus after all. So if you take those two sentences, if you take the first sentence, the two occurrences of Hesperus there refer to the same thing, right? Kind of obviously so. But the two occurrences of Hesperus and phosphorus in number 2 also refer to the same thing, but less obviously so. Right, so there's co-reference, so there's co-reference, co-reference in both 1 and 2. They both refer to the same object, Venus. But in 1, but our epistemic attitude towards co-reference is different in these cases. It's kind of obvious in the first case, less obvious in this in the second case. So this first case, I want to say there's, you know, so that's the case of the jury reference, coordination, linking, etc. Okay. In the other case,
could you please define the jury? Quickly, I'm a bit fussy about the definition of the jury.
I haven't given a definition of it. Just means, so let me contrast it with, I will try to say more about this. I'm just trying to get you to lock onto it. And then once you lock on to it sort of intuitively, then I'm going to give you like a test for it a little bit later.
Sorry, I thought you were presupposing that we were in.
No, I wasn't presupposing. So I want to contrast it with de facto coreference. So then there is de facto coreference. So that's the next thing I was going to say. So it's kind of de jure, kind of like by law or something like that, or by stipulation. So if you look at the two occurrences of Hesperus, there's like something like by semantics or by law or stipulation or something like that, that they're coreferential. But in number 2, Hesperus and phosphorus corefer, but it's not like by stipulation that they corefer. It's kind of like, you know, depends on the facts about astronomy or something like that. So that's the idea. So it's although there's coreference in both cases, there's a difference that with the distinction that we need to make. This extends beyond proper names. So it's not just an issue about proper names. It's not just an issue about Frege's puzzle and like Hesperus phosphorus type cases. So if you look at 3, 4, and 5, you'll see, for instance, that man looks thirsty, he needs a drink. So that's number 5. So that man pointing at a man that looks thirsty, he needs a drink. So he and that man there are coordinated, or the jure corefer, right? Sort of like, so an aphora gives you a very sort of, those are very good examples of coordinated coreference. Okay? And it can be between people. Imagine Pelé and Maradona having a conversation. Pelé saying that Messi's a great player. Maradona saying that he's overrated. Maradona is using he to link up to what Pelé was saying. And so in that case, there's a type of coordination. There's also reasoning. You can reason in natural language in the sense that I can present an argument using language, natural language. Formal languages. So that's 8 and 9. I think they present kind of an interesting case. Is that what I have? With respect to a model, A and B could refer to the same thing. And you can know that they refer to the same thing if you look at the model, if you look at what A is assigned and B is assigned in the language. But Here, you know, A and A refer to the same thing, but you don't have to look at them all, right? You just have to know how, you know, just to know something about formal languages. So you know that there's coreference here in this case. You know there's coreference here in this case in the particular model, but the way you know that is different, right? You don't have to even look at the model for for this sentence. You just, in fact, it's true in all models, right? It's false in all models, right? So yeah, the reason why you know it's false in all models is because in part because I think you know that A occurrence is important. Okay, so, but again, if you look at how the semantic formal languages, coordination is never made explicit. It's never made explicit in the semantics that these two occurrences have to refer to the same thing. In fact, there really isn't, in formal languages, there really isn't a lot of appeal to occurrences of terms. They just talk about types of terms. Except when it comes to talking about variables, and when you talk about variables, variables are bound or not bound, free variables, those definitions appeal to occurrences. But otherwise, there's a lot of just appeal to types of expressions. Okay, so, but what's interesting about the formal language is that in logic, you know, what you care about is inference. Right. So you might think that the fact that the Jurek reference or linking appears so prominently in formal languages that it's very important in inference. But also, on the other hand, the fact that linking or coordination is not made explicit in formal languages reveals that it just flows or follows from other deeper principles about language and representation. But it's not something that is you need to make be explicit about it. Something just flows from something else. And I'm going to say how it can flow from something. I'm going to say what these other things are that can lead to that. Can explain that. Okay, so finally, I think you also get it for, you have coordination in pictorial representations. So there's a little cartoon of Calvin and Hobbes. So if you understand the cartoon, the comic strip, right, you'll know that each of the panels represents the same person, right? So it's, so the depictions of Calvin is the cat? No. Which one is the cat? Calvin is the kid? Okay. So you know that they, you might not even know who Calvin is, but you can still laugh or not laugh at this cartoon, right? And you'll recognize that these depictions are about the same person. So there's coordination there. And if you didn't get that, then you probably wouldn't understand the cartoon. If you're like, oh, I wonder, is that the same kid? Like, if you were thinking like that, then you probably wouldn't even understand what's going on. Whereas you can have the fact of a representation in a cartoon or pictorial depictions. I mean, suppose I tell you, look, Calvin is Hobbes. In fact, Hobbes is just, you know, basically just Calvin himself. It's just a depiction of him talking to himself. Right? So you can have some sort of interpretation of the cartoon is actually the same person. And it wouldn't be part of understanding the cartoon that you have to get that. That's just, you know, something else. So that would be the fact of correlations. All right. Finally, just very briefly, so the Jurek reference. So philosophers have really gotten into where they've discussed the Jurek reference the most has been at the level of thought. Okay, because there it seems like reasoning requires a type of linking or coordination among the parts of your thought, and you know, it's not hard to come up with examples. So any type of reasoning, right? So just the most opponent's reasoning, you're going to be coordinating the different parts of yourself. To wrap up the section, so linking or coordination is prevalent all over the place. It seems pretty important. Suppose it didn't happen, or suppose there wasn't coordination, then every time I have to think, every time I want to communicate about the same object, or every time I want to have a thought about the same object, it would be like kind of like a Hesperus phosphorus type case. I'd be like, I have to re-identify. I'd be like, okay, is that the same object that I was thinking about like a second ago? And it would just make, I don't want to say that coordination is essential to language or thought. Maybe there could be thought without it or language without it, but it would just be very different. And it wouldn't be a very efficient way to communicate or think. So I think it's very important component to thought and language. Okay. So let's be a little bit more rigorous about this. So let's consider now some tests by which we can come to recognize when we have coordination. Okay, so there are various tests that people have given in the literature. Some tests I don't like because they're very theory-laden, so they appeal to mental files, or they appeal to Freudian senses, or they appeal to indexing, and those are not good tests because I might not know what these things are, right? So this depends on a lot of theory. So I prefer tests that are theory-neutral. So Kit Fines gives a test, Kit Fines gives a test, and I give a test that's theory-neutral. So I want to just spend a little bit of time kind of fuzzing about the test, just because it's good to think carefully about these things. So so let's look at Fine's test. So here's a quote from Fine. Give your hand up. A good test for when an object is represented as the same, and that's just coordination, that's just the de jure reference, is in terms of whether one might sensibly raise the question of whether it is the same. That's what he says. An object is represented as the same coordination in a piece of discourse only if no one who understands the discourse can sensibly raise the question of whether it is the same. This is a little bit unclear to me because I don't really know what the it is, so whether it, so I guess I can't raise the, I mean, I guess is it sensible to raise the question whether an object is the same? I guess is the same as itself? Maybe a metaphysician can raise that question, so maybe it is sensible to raise the question. But suppose it's not sensible to raise a question about whether an object is the same. What does that have to do with the discourse? What does that have to do with Hesperus and Fock, you know, the various occurrences of Hesperus? So there's nothing in that little first part that tells us how that connects up to language. It's just, so then in the second part of this, he makes it a little bit clearer. So he says, so he continues, says, suppose you say Cicero is an orator, and later say Cicero was honest, intended to make the very same use of the name Cicero, then anyone who raises the question of whether the reference was the same would thereby betray his lack of understanding of what you meant. Right, so if you could, and so I gloss this as the following. This is what I call the Finian test, V version 1. Okay, so if representation occurrences A and B de jure are coordinated in the discourse, then if an agent understands the discourse, they cannot sensibly raise the question of whether A and B refer to the same thing. So if I say Hesperus is near the sun, and Hesperus is my favorite planet, then if you understood what I said, you cannot sensibly raise the question whether those two Hesperus occurrences refer to the same thing. Because you, by understanding, something like by understanding the utterance, you get that for free. Okay. Whereas with Hesperus and Phosphorus, you could raise a question. And if I say Hesperus is F, Phosphorus is G, you might be like, I understand that, but I'm not sure that Hesperus is Phosphorus. And I just looked at the newspaper today, and astronomers seem to there's disagreement about whether Hesperus is Phosphorus, and that kind of thing, right? So, okay, so here's a problem with this first version of this test. So, consider 10. Steve thinks that if Jonah had gotten eaten by a big fish, Jonah the biblical character, he would have died right away. Okay, so can you raise a question? So I take it that Jonah and he are going to be coordinated in that case, and they're going to be de jure co-referential. Let's suppose that Jonah does refer to a biblical character, as Kripke said. Okay, so so I take it that those two are coordinated, Jonah and he. their length, this is just a case of an aqueduct. But I could sensibly raise a question about whether they refer to the same thing, because I could sensibly raise a question about whether Jonah refers at all. Right? It could be like, I don't know. I mean, is it, I understand what you're saying, but I'm not sure Jonah really existed, because it's kind of a weird story about, you might think that there's too much fiction in the story for it to be like a real person, that kind of thing, whatever, right? But still, the jury court referentialists assume that Jonah does refer, so the test fails for that reason, for these non-referential cases. Okay. So then what I like is a conditional coreference test. So you basically say, if there's reference, then they're going to refer to the same thing. So this is version two. So if representation occurrences A and B are coordinated in a discourse, then if nature understands a discourse, they cannot sensibly raise the question of whether A and B refer to the same thing, if they refer at all. So you can't raise the question. So in the case of Jonah, I can doubt perhaps that Jonah is a real person, but I can't doubt this, right? So if Jonah refers, then they refer to the same thing. So that seems right to me, that so long as Jonah refers, then the Jonah and he are going to refer to the same thing. Okay, so here's a problem now. Okay, I think that's an improvement on Fine's test. Okay, here's another problem with Fine's test. It requires this notion of sensibly raising a question. So what does it mean to sensibly raise a question about something? So take a discourse where there's coordination, but where there's urgency in communication. Right, so it's supposed to say, danger, the tiger has escaped. He's right behind you. So there, the tiger and he are coordinated or linked. But I can't sensibly raise the question of whether the tiger and he refer to the same thing, because it's like, this is no time to be asking questions about what refers to them. This is time to run away from the tiger. It's not the time to be asking questions about coreference, philosophy, right? It's just run. So obviously the sense of sensibly raising a question here is not just epistemic sense, but a practical sense. So then you have to ask, what does it mean to epistemically sensibly raise a question about something? And I don't know. So I just say, let's just, when I go into epistemology, I just take knowledge first. So let's just do the test in terms of knowledge that seems to get things right. So I proposed in my dissertation and in some later papers, this other test called knowledge of conditional coreference. So if representation occurrences A and B are the jury coreferential in the discourse, and if an agent understands the discourse, they know that A and B refer to the same thing if they refer it up. Okay, so it requires knowledge. So when you understand, then you, in the jury coreferential case, then you know the conditional thing. If they refer to them, they refer to the same thing. And take a case like Hess versus Phosphorus. So in that case, right, I can understand Hess versus Phosphorus, but it's not the jury coreferential, right? So it's not the case that I know that if they refer to the same thing. Why is that? Because I might believe that they don't refer to the same thing. I can still understand Hess versus Phosphorus and disagree with you, right? I don't have to agree with you to understand what you're saying. So by disagreeing with you, when you say Hess versus Phosphorus, I can understand, and I can disagree with you, and if I disagree with you, I won't know that if the terms refer, then they refer to the same thing. I will deny that they refer to the same thing. So I think that's a better test, and I do some epistemology aside, and I think about knowledge a lot, so I like it this way better. All right, so let me now just give you some explanations. Let me just give you the Frege explanation of the yes. So
just because I proceed in the difference is you should can know. The knowledge, it's not can know, but actually know, right?
Yeah, so I think, so if I'm careful, I'll say can know. If I'm not careful, then I'll say no. So the official thing is can know. Right. You're in a position to know, right? Because it, you might not think about it, assuming you think about it. Good question. Okay. So the Phrygian explanation, so appeals to Phrygian senses. So here's some facts about Phrygian senses. They are the meaning of terms, which are, they're the meaning of our expressions. And these, are, these meanings are grasped by competent speakers. Then the other thing that, so they do a lot of work for Frege, right? So that, the other thing is that Frege's senses of a term refers to an object O is, so the sense is gonna be like a way of thinking of that object O and like motor presentation of that object O. The other thing about Frege's senses is that they determine reference uniquely. So given a sense and given the world, there's going to be one object at most that the sense refers to. And then the various views about what this is, so the way Kripke interpreted Frege, the way that reference happens is that the sense encodes some description and the world, some object in the world has to satisfy that description. The way that Recanati and Evans think of Phrygian senses, they think that the relation, the reference relation is one of more like a causal historical relation. So there are different views about that. But it's not gonna matter for our purposes which way to go. And also now finally, this transparent bit is what's crucial for the de jure coreference thing. So the Phrygian sense is transparent, so that if you grasp the same sense twice, you will know that they are the same sense. And if you grasp two different senses, you will know that they're different senses, right? Or are in a position to know. Okay. So they're completely transparent. And in the literature, you know, people say, yeah, Frege needs this to solve Frege's puzzle. So if you don't have these, this transparency constraint, then what's the point of Frege's theory? It doesn't even account for these puzzles on rationality. Okay. So here's Frege's account of linking or de jure coreference or coordination. Very simple. When are two terms coordinated, or two occurrences coordinated? When they have expressed the same sense. When are two occurrences not coordinated? When they express different senses, which is exactly what you get as for this Frege solution to Hesper's solution. So it's the same sense, and these are different senses. Right. And so that's, so coordination is just, you know, you get that. That's the sort of straightforward account of coordination, Phrygian account of coordination. Which now it's very nice because it gets you the right account for the test that I gave you, the conditional coreference test. Why is that? Because if you have coordination, then that means it's the same sense involved. And if I accompany the speaker, if I understand the discourse, I will grasp the senses. And since senses are transparent, I'll be able to figure out that it's actually the same sense. And now since I know the senses determine the reference uniquely, I'll be able to conclude that the occurrences refer to the same thing, if they refer at all. So you get a very nice account of why the test works if you accept this Phrygian conception of the jure coreference coordination. It's very nice. I mean, the more I, yeah.
How do you make the difference between the jure and the fact coreference for the Phrygian?
For the Phrygian, yeah. So in this case, right, I can grasp. So there are different senses for Frege, right? So Frege will say, well, this is this sense, this expresses this sense, they're different senses, but just because they're different senses, I can't conclude whether they're the same, whether the reference is the same or not, because two different senses could refer to the same object, or they could refer to different objects. So the facto coreference
It's just a failure of the juridic reference. So there's no, so if you have this situation where you're grasping two different senses, you're not in a position just from that to know that these two senses refer to the same thing. So therefore, it's not the juridic reference, and therefore it's the fact of the reference. So that's the idea. You're kind of like, you've got these two senses, and you're like, okay, well, do they refer to the same thing or not? Well, I don't know. I don't know yet, because sometimes two different senses refer to the same thing, sometimes they don't. So you're not in a position to know automatically that they refer to the same thing. And you want that kind of guarantee for the if you think that the terms are coordinated. Okay, so there's some worries about senses. You might think they don't exist. So people have argued that there's no such thing as senses, right? There's nothing that satisfies these conditions. Like transparency, you might think senses are not transparent. So there goes the theory. All the other things, kind of a more subtle point, is that on this view, coordination depends on the identity of senses, right? So these two are coordinated just in case they express the same sense, numerically identical sense. Now what that means is that coordination is, so, and identity is a transitive relation. So what that means is that coordination is a transitive relation. So in this view, the Frege solution actually is not as innocent as you might think it is. It actually commits you to the transitivity of coordination. Transitivity means, so the transitive relation is one such that, the transitive relation R is such that if X R is to Y and Y R is to Z, then X R is to Z. And I've actually argued elsewhere that coordination is not transitive. So then I say, So that argument is supposed to be kind of like a master argument against all of these views that say that appeal to identity. But let's forget about the problems with Frege. Let's forget about transitivity worries. Let's just assume that those worries can be met. Now, let's see. Make sure I'm okay with time. Yeah. So, okay, so that's Frege's solution. Now I'm talking about Kip Fine's solution. So this is the thing that so he has a book on this semantic relationism, and it's Oxford. There's done a lot of lectures around this topic. So, if the relation is a solution, I'm going to explain to you why it's a relation is a solution. It's because there's a semantic relation between these two occurrences. It cannot be reduced to other semantic notions that are not linking these two things. And so let me just be a little more clear about that. So let's look at 11, 12, and 13. So it might be a semantic fact that a certain word like A refers to an object O, that's 11, and it also might be a semantic fact that B refers to O, so it could be like Hesperus and Phosphorus, but it doesn't follow that it's a semantic fact that there's an X such that A and B refer to X. This is Kip Fine, and so by a semantic fact, Kip Fine just means, so Fine thinks that there's a realm of the semantic, and there are facts that are in that realm, and there are facts that are not in that realm, like just facts in another world or something like that. And within that realm, if you take all the propositions in that realm, the structure of that realm or the feature of that realm is such that it's not closed in a logical consequence. So what that means is that 11 and 12 don't entail 13. And basically what that means is that 13, which is an expression of coordination, so coordination is just 13. 13 is just a semantic fact, there's an X such that A and B refer to X. It's like in virtue of meaning, something like that. Semantic fact is like in virtue of meaning. So in virtue of meaning, there's an X such that A and B refer to X. That's coordination for Kip Fine. And he says, okay, that's coordination. Notice how it relates A and B. But that cannot be explained by 11 and 12. So you cannot just, you cannot reduce that, you cannot explain that by just saying something about A on its own, A referring to O on its own, and B referring to O on its own. Those things are not enough to get you that further semantic fact. I think this is kind of not an easy notion to get, and it's still not clear to me how exactly. I mean, I've been working on it for a while, so it's, I mean, I get it, but I'm not 100% confident that I get it. But let me give you now my relation has been, I think it's clearer, because it's just, in a way, simpler. So I can agree with the fact 11, 12, not entailing 13, but I can do a different account. I can just say, look, there's just this primitive relation, primitive semantic relation. In a theory of semantics, let's say, there is this relation, let's just call it P linking. Primitive linking. And it's just a fact, right? It's just a fact about these occurrences, these words, that they're P-linked. And in these cases, there's no P-linking. I just get to say what I wanted to say when I was in college, that there is this coordination that needs to be built into the semantics, right? So here it is. It's just, I'm just going to say that there is just this relation that's linking the two. And so I'm a primitivist about this. So I think there's a primitive relation, this P-linking relation, and that it cannot be reduced to other, semantically it cannot be reduced to other things. It just has to be there on top of the semantics. So here's why, briefly, why I think Giffon is wrong in thinking that there is no, so he, you know, he hates the linking, he hates the primitivist. So he doesn't, you know, we've talked about this, so he says, no, that's wrong, and I think he's wrong. Given that he's a very smart person, but right. But I have some reason to think that I'm right. So I'll tell you what the reason is. So the reason is that his notion, his analysis of coordination is a fact of notion, and that it actually requires actual reference to the world. So A and B are coordinated for him, just in case there is an object, it's an existential quantifier. There is an object that A and B both refer to. Just, I guess it's a semantic fact that there's an object that both A and B refer to. But I think there's also coordination between non-referring expressions. So if I think Santa Claus is coming to town, he's bringing presents, he and Santa Claus are linked. But it's not the case that semantic required that there's an object, right, that is the reference of Santa Claus and he. So by going primitive, as I say, look, there is just this one notion that's underlying both the factive case and the non-factive case, the referential case and non-referential case. Giffon has some problems, I think, so the way he handles the non-referring case is not successful. So argue in print that way is not successful, but let's not worry about that. Here's the problem for the relationist view, and a big benefit for the Frege view. And it has to do with a certain asymmetry. So if you see an asymmetry in the world, then I think you need some sort of explanation for that asymmetry. There's something, when I say an asymmetry, there's something sort of I get worried about, right? So I want to point to a certain asymmetry in the empirical facts about language and thought. And the asymmetry cannot be explained by the relationist perspective, but it can be explained very elegantly, very nicely by Frege. Here's the asymmetry. So so you can define a notion of de jure anti-coreference. Kind of like anti-linking or something like that. So in linking, it's like you got two occurrences and you know that they refer to the same thing, just by understanding the discourse. With anti-linking, it's like you got two occurrences and you know they refer to different things, just by understanding the discourse. But here's my claim, empirical claim. For simple terms, anti-linking really does not exist in natural language or thought. But linking does. So there's an asymmetry, a very important asymmetry in language and thought. These things don't exist in natural language, but linking does. Kit Fine's theory cannot really account for this. Because for him, linking is just semantically required some fact about coreference. But he allows that other things to be semantically required. His view has a lot of latitude. Right? It's, you can say other things, like the fact that an extension is included in another extension, that could be semantically required. So that the extension of dog is a subset of the extension of mammal, that's semantically required. So he knows all types of things in semantic requirement that can be semantically required. And that's nice because you have a lot of leeway. But when you have a theory with a lot of leeway, you're also going to get some costs, which you're going to have to explain some negative facts, right? Why doesn't your theory then say that there is, it should, your theory should predict that there is major or anti-coreference? And same thing with me. Like, I'm just, you know, kind of like a simple-minded guy, just saying, hey, there's just linking, it's a primitive linking thing between these two occurrences. Why aren't they? So you might ask, well, why isn't there a primitive anti-linking relation? Why doesn't that exist? Okay, so here's, let me just give you sort of a flavor of why I think that there's no anti-linking. Maybe you think there is anti-linking. But suppose I say something like, Bill Clinton has recommended Joseph Biden for the position. I think that's in the let's see. No. Okay. But suppose you say, you know, Bill Clinton is recommending Joseph Biden for the position. I understand that sentence. We all understand that sentence. And we all know. We all know that Joseph Biden and Bill Clinton refer to different people. Right? We know that, right? So you might think, well, isn't that a case of anti-linking? Isn't that a case of the jury anti-coreference? I say no, because the test is this. The test is, if you understand the sentence, then you will know that they refer to different things. But it's not the case that if you understand the sentence, you will think that they refer to different things. Why? Because you could just have this weird view, weird metaphysical view, where Joseph Biden is Bill Clinton. I mean, it's kind of a cheesy, corny case, but I think what that points is that if you do think that those two terms refer to different things, it's kind of like in virtue of your view of metaphysics. It's not virtue of like meaning or semantics, right? It's just in virtue of some other facts, which is, of course, you know that they refer to different people. And you can also, you know, you can imagine someone who thinks that we're all one, right? So we're all one person, right? So we're all just, so there's just one person, and this is just one manifestation of this person, and Carl is a manifestation of the same person. I think that's a false view, but it's not like when you understand language that comes for free. It's not that it's like a semantic thing. It's just like a metaphysical. All right. So let me just say how. Let me just finish by. I'm not going to get to the end. I'm already spoken too long. But let me just finish by. Just saying, talking about Frege's elegant solution. So Frege gets to say why there's no anti-coreference, why there's no anti-linking. It's a very nice solution, and it comes from, it's like the principled solution. It's not just, you know, this extra thing tacked on. It's like basic principles from Frege, and then you get from those principles that this prediction is amazing prediction that there is linking but no anti-linking. So let's see how that works. So it just requires A, B, and C on your handout that names have senses as meaning, which are grasped by competent users, and determine the reference. I packed three assumptions into one, so I just wanted to make it smaller. So senses are transparent, again, and there's an external one, because let me explain how that's supposed to work. So here's the proof that you get from Frege. It's not in Frege, but this is a proof that there should be linking, but no anti-linking. So, taking the two expressions, they're either two options. They either express the same sense, or they express different senses. Those are the two options. Okay, let's just take one option at a time. So let's suppose that they express the same sense. then since you're a competent user, you understand those expressions, then you will know that did they refer to the same thing, right? Because senses are transparent, right? You know it's the same sense, that's transparency, and senses refer uniquely, so then you know that they refer to the same thing. So that's the jure coreference. But here's the other option. The senses are different. So take two expressions. Imagine, so option one, the senses are the same, and they just said that's the case of the jure coreference. The other option, senses are different. And in that case, if the senses are different, can I conclude anything about whether they co-refer or not? Right? We just said that we can't, right? Because two different senses could refer to the same thing, like in testers and phosphors, or they could just refer to different things. And so you don't get then the jure anti-coreference. So suppose that all you have available to you in semantics is just a comparison of senses, right? So sort of like that. Algebra of senses or something like that. So the simple picture, if all you got are just comparison of senses, the same or different, then when you notice that they're the same, then you get blinking, you notice they're different, right, nothing. So you don't get, so there's no, you don't get any type of de jure anti-coreference. So here's why I think you need an external world. This is not a requirement, this is not a necessary feature of senses. Here's why. Suppose Berkeley was right, and Bishop Berkeley was right, and so it's all, there's no external world, there's no, you wouldn't say it that way, right? But suppose it's all just ideas, right? So suppose it's all just senses. And so we grasp these senses, and our thoughts are made up of senses, but the senses like refer to themselves, because there's nothing else out there. Then in that case, you would get this jure anti-coreference, right? Because you would, if you have two different senses, you would notice that they're different senses. And that's all there is, so it would be the jure anti-coreference. So when you notice different senses, you know that there would be anti-coreference, and if you notice that they're the same sense, then there would be coreference. So in a world, if there's no external world, then you do get a nice symmetry of the jure coreference and the jure anti-coreference. But this, you know, this external world thing comes in, and then you get the difference. You get the asymmetry. So springing up with external world explains the asymmetry. Okay. So I think I should stop there. Let's see. Yes. Okay. Okay. So that's all. Thank you. Someone take questions? Carol, can you take
questions? I can take questions for you.
I have a bunch, but given that the anti-linking is fresh, so what about a sentence like A is not identical to B? It seems like if you understand the sentence right away, you know that there is anti-linking, right? You kind of follow with a question. Hold on, is it that A and B are co-referential? Because then you betray your understanding of the discourse.
Right. So A is not B.
Right.
Well, I mean, suppose the ancient said Hesperus is not phosphorus. I will actually not know that they refer to different things, right? Because I might think that they actually do refer to the same thing. So somebody can utter A is not B, Hesperus is not phosphorus. In a case, and I can understand them, even when Hesperus and phosphorus do refer to the same thing. And me as a hearer, I can be like, yeah, I mean, I know you're saying that, but I think you're mistaken, right? That's what I would, that's how I would respond to you if you said Hesperus is not phosphorus. So I can understand what you say, and still not know that they refer to different things. So in sum, this wouldn't be a case of this jure anti-coreference.
But maybe it's because I'm still hooked with a fine way of the fine test.
Yeah.
Because I thought the test is a matter of figuring out whether you are understanding what
Yeah.
The speaker wants to say, not whether what the speaker says is true or false.
Right.
So if you understand what the information the speaker wants to convey,
yeah,
when she says A is not identical to B, it's pretty clear that if you understand what she wants to say, whether it's true or not,
yeah,
then you cannot ask whether they are preferential or not. And then you may think then there is anti-linking. But of course, it's,
right,
you have reasons to reject that test. So,
well, even that test, I mean, why can't you challenge a speaker? Right, so somebody, I mean, if somebody says, right, Hesper is not phosphorus, you would challenge them. You would be like, wait a second, no, I do want to raise this doubt, right, about whether they refer to this thing about different things.
But you can agree with me that the question you cannot ask is, do you mean to say that they are not preferential? That's a different question from,
or different
from affirming they are not preferential. So you cannot ask whether the intentions of the speaker were to refer to different things.
Yes.
And I thought that was the linking issue.
Right. So it's not about the intention of the speaker, because intentions can go awry, right? So it's about, what I like about linking is that it's not just that you have an intention. It's like there's success, right? So that if the terms refer, then they refer to the same thing. Intention is not... What?
It does, because it's the jury reference?
Yes,
okay.
It's a very tight notion. Let me say something about intentions, right? So intentions are not enough to give you the jury reference. Here's why, right? So if I just say, right, Hesperus is a planet, if I say Hesperus is F, let's just do that. Suppose I believe that Hesperus is phosphorus,
mm-hmm,
and I say Hesperus is phosphorus. I intend Hesperus and phosphorus to refer to the same thing. That's part of my intention, but they're not coordinated. Right. They're not, so it's just a simple case of Hesperus and phosphorus is not, there's no coordination. Because you need coordination. This is just a basic case where if you say there's no coordination here, then you give up on the project. Because this is the first result you're supposed to get, that is that there's no coordination here. But there's still intention to co-refer here. So intention to co-refer is not sufficient for the jury co-reference. This is a point that was made by Evans originally. So he said, so he was wondering about these linking relations. And so the issue was whether it was just a matter of intending to refer to the same thing. And this actually kind of what got me interested in it, because I thought maybe that's all there is to it, it's just intending to refer to the same thing. But it's not. So that's why it's kind of interesting. It's actually more than just the intentions. It's like something about meaning that they have to be linked. So in this case, they're not.
Sebas. Oh, is this a follow?
My question is, I think just a follow up of what Ricardo was mentioning, but it's even in presented in a naive way. So it's not clear to me what it means to understand a discourse. So if I say Messi shoot and Casillas stop the ball, and someone asks me, is Casillas and Messi the same person, I say, you have not understand what I'm saying.
Right.
So if one condition is understanding the discourse,
yeah,
then there might be, I mean, it seems to me that understanding the discourse requires anti-linking.
Yeah. Well, right. So what I would say about that case is that now we would have to refine the test a little bit. So I get that objection. I think that's a good objection. So I would have to kind of like say something. Ultimately, what I want to say is that it arises from the understanding, and it's sort of like in the case of Messi and. I would say that suppose somebody had that weird metaphysical view, right? That we all want, Right, so Casillas and Messi are actually the same person.
Why did you look at me when you say that weird?
Because you're metaphysics. Because I don't know, I just have to go into metaphysics. So, this is weird. So, okay, suppose you have that view. Okay, so you get the view. So it's just one person, and this is like, this body is just like one sort of like a manifestation of the person. And then that body will be different manifestation of the same person. And then you can have that view. I mean, there might be people who have that view. Okay, do they not understand language? Would they not understand the thing that the audience you just made?
Okay, then I can just come to this discourse. So I don't believe that these kind of metaphysical views are true, and Messi should, and Casillas say the
right. So you can say that, right? But it's about somebody. It's about the discourse, right? So the person you're talking to could agree that that's what you believe, right? But they might still have the weird metaphysical view. So the discourse, just because you say you don't believe in the metaphysical view, doesn't mean that anybody who understands your discourse has to agree with you that your metaphysical view is correct.
So he's gonna be able to ask me, oh, and they are.
So he'd just be like, maybe they're the same person. Okay. But for de jure, you need that if you understand, then you know that they're different people. In this case, this person doesn't know that.
So just try to complicate things to play around. So somebody says, who is a different person from B, blah, blah, did something to me. Yeah. If you have this metaphysical view, you're not going to understand my sentence.
I think you could understand it, but they all understand it differently. Kind of like when a nominalist talks to, it's kind of like a metaphysics. So a nominalist will still understand talking numbers, 5, 6, 7, but they'll have a translation manual. So maybe this weird metaphysics person will have some sort of translation manual. When people talk about, you know, Biden and Clinton, they're just talking about different manifestations of the same person or something like that. And so they'll have that kind of understanding of what people are saying. So. But thanks, yeah.
I was thinking about cases where several different people have the same name, and a discourse where perhaps not very sensibly, but people are using the name repeatedly, but they're referring to different people.
Yeah.
With it.
So they're all, because you think that they're all Tom or something?
I mean, you might think that. I mean, my question, I guess, is that it seems like in that case, various of the pairs are de jure referential. But it seems like someone who was unsure about that would have, in some sense, understood the discourse. Or if you deny that, then it starts to seem like you've got quite a strong requirement on understanding discourse, because you would normally want to say that having the independent way of figuring out which object was required. And, that's like, is that a word for the test? Or?
So here's, I'm going to try to flesh out your example a little bit, right? So suppose I'm confused. Suppose Carl has a twin, right? So I say every time I see you, I think it's just one person. So every time I see you, I'll say Carla. I say, oh, that's Carla. Every time I see your twin, I say, oh, so that's Carla, right? And I might think, and then I think Carla. I've seen Carla drink a glass of red wine, and I've seen the other Carla, the twin Carla, eat some cheese, and so then I think, oh, Carla likes wine, Carla likes cheese,
And then I conclude something like, Carol likes wine and cheese or something. We should take her to the wine and cheese party. So you might think those two thoughts are de jure co-referential, right? Maybe the first thought kind of is about her, the other one is about the twin, but I think they're the same person, I'm using the same name. So is the idea that they're kind of linked or something like that? Even though they refer to different people?
I think that's like different case, where it's not that I'm confused, I'm just having this conversation, I'm part of the conversation about having other people talk, and they're using Carla to refer to different people knowing me. So then there's a bunch of Carla likes cheese, Carla likes wine,
yeah,
things that I've heard.
Yeah.
And I think, well, I don't know actually whether all businesses for Carla vote the same person or to two different people. So I don't know that they all get companies refer to the same person. But I understood.
Yeah.
Perhaps. Or if I haven't understood it, it's just
Yeah, so maybe you're thinking that you don't really understand. So you're eavesdropping, right? You might know if people are using, you might not understand.
People know that I'm bad. I don't have to be like,
okay. Yeah, so, I mean, so one thing you might say is like, you could say, I don't understand. Can you clarify? So that'd be like a natural thing for you to say. And that's indication that you don't understand. The fact that you say it and you don't understand. So maybe, so that's one thing I can say in the negative, is that you don't understand. So then the test can apply.
I thought.
It's just a similar worry to what Ricardo said about asking.
The things that,
I mean, I'm not convinced about the way of denying that there is the Julian anti-correct. Because, I mean, if you introduce this kind of metaphysical view, then it seems to be in some way legitimate then to introduce another weird metaphysical view to deny that there is the jure corruption, right? Because then you would say, well, no, I mean, I have this view that here's one object, but then after a moment there is not that object anymore, and I don't have a view, I mean, a unified view of thinking of these things as different stages of the same thing. I just don't have this view. I say, this is one thing, this is another thing. And you say, and suppose you say, well, Hesper is over there. Look, Hesper is shining very, very beautiful. And it is shining again. And then you will say, well, there should be the Eureka reference.
Yeah.
But then there is this person who says, no, I don't know. I mean, I understand the discourse, but I don't know that they refer to the same thing. Actually, they refer to different things.
Thank you. Yeah, it's very good. Yeah, so that's sort of the same thing. So yeah, so Hess versus F, Hess versus G, but these are different times, right?
Yeah.
So these are kind of like, these are observational, these are sort of like perceptual beliefs, right? Hess versus over there, Hess.
There's just a discourse, I mean.
This is a discourse, okay. Well, but, So now the metaphysical view is that objects don't last, they are just like instantaneous. So every, Hesper is just a bunch of, so it's just like a bunch of stages, that kind of thing. So that's my view, right? So I'm the one that's speaking, or,
I'm hearing someone, yeah.
I'm hearing someone say it. So I hear someone say this, and so they're a regular person, so they think they're talking about the same object. Is that right?
Yes. Yeah, but intentional or not relevant.
Intentional is the same object, right? So it's just a normal case. Yeah. That's where it's at. Right? And I'm like, do I understand? Does that person understand? I guess I would say, if I want to say the same thing as I said before, I would say, yeah, they do understand. They get along in the world. Yeah, so this is, better positions do have views like this.
Yeah.
Right? So I do understand. One thing that happens Okay, so I don't know if this is going to be inconsistent with what I said before, so I appreciate that. But so I'm trying to think of what the metaphysician, because I would imagine in the other metaphysical view that I was proposing, the one with just one person, I could imagine a translation manual from ordinary speech to my speech with my ideology with just one person. So I kind of have to understand what's happening here with this translation manual between people talking about an object that lasts through time, and then my time slice view. Let's see, what would I say about if I had that view?
Let me speak here.
Yeah, Ricardo wants to say something.
Yeah,
And maybe a fallback position would be to say, well, if that's the case, then the number of the Dirac referential cases are much limited than we thought. Here will be an example. Hesperus is beautiful at time t,
right,
and Hesperus is bright at time t.
Right.
That would still be a case of the Dirac reference, even if we hold this crazy metaphysics.
Right, so one thing you could say, some people talk about, so when they, when you think about reasoning. So Recanati says things like it's going to be a synchronic event. So you're going to take all these things to be about the same time. So if you want to limit the Dirac reference to reasoning, then you can respond in that way. I actually don't like that. I think if I want a sort of a real world view of reasoning where it's dynamic. We're actually moving, perhaps using different senses, and I think linking can help. Can help in that case. So I think just from experience, I'm just going to think about this a little bit more. I think I can sort of like try some things, but I'd rather wait a little bit. But thanks for sending this sort of similar worries. Thanks.
There's a bunch of repeats, but I have this, so I'll ask it. Can I just say a quick follow-up on that?
Yeah.
But I think what Ricardo's suggesting helps you even if you don't like it, right? Because I'm very... I mean, maybe you want to say more, but at very least this whole acquisition is good for you because you still have cases.
You still have the Dirac reference, yeah.
And, yeah, you can still make the case, right? Okay. So this is not like that central, but I was not convinced by C on F. So, Frege and Twende is symmetry in another way, and then you gave three conditions.
Yep.
And then you added there is an external world.
Yep.
And then the reason was that if you're a bird queen, then maybe it says it referred to themselves, and then they will be. And I was thinking, even if you're a bird queen, senses would refer to other senses, right? And so you don't need to have an external world, you just need senses not to refer to themselves.
Yeah, so I should say Berkeleyan, where the senses refer to themselves.
Right, but this is stronger than
that. Is strong, yeah, C is strong, so it's not just an external world. It's,
yeah.
It's some sort of self-reference. Thank you.
Yeah, okay, so then we have Sebas again.
But just to press you a little bit more, not that you have to give me it's just so if you go with Ricardo, I think that was what you had in mind. The reason why you don't like, if I were you, I wouldn't take Ricardo's proposal, is that there are many reasons that we need, if you are right, and we need linking,
yeah,
has to go through time or something like that.
Yeah.
So it's
but not if you have to look
up. Another reason why you shouldn't take is possibly. No, it's because you can think of even weirder metaphysical positions. You can think of a position that says there's an external world, but there's no meaning in talking about parts of the world. You can only refer to the whole world as that. So Hesperus, there's nothing that. So you can always come up with an even crazier metaphysical view that would like reduce to zero.
Which you do.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. I'm worried about Derrida. So at some point, because my test says, the test says, right, you know that if they refer, if the expressions refer, then they refer to the same thing. So you might be a skeptic about reference, right? You might be, so you might not know anything about reference because you just don't believe that there is, you know, this mind-world relation. So so how I dealt with that case in my dissertation was saying that you can't really believe that there's no reference. So because you can't really understand language without having this notion of reference. So you can say your theories, these things. But here's why I think you do. So to understand speech, right? To understand, I have to do many things. Like, for instance, I have to resolve an affirmative. I have to figure out what it is that you mean to talk about. And I don't know how you figure out what it is that you mean to talk about without having the resources. I'm some few mind.
So I
don't think
solution, even if you have to restrict it even more, because I don't think it will come down to zero, as Aliyah was suggesting, because even if the whole world, you think that's one, then you can refer to it and say different things about it, and you'll need linking in that case. So I think you might just say, I don't know what things could be linked, maybe that somehow, I'm not sure, but maybe that's a hostage of metaphysical views or not, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But there's going to be at least some cases, if there's going to be discourse in which you need linkage,
mm-hmm.
and you don't need anti-linking, but I mean, that's just
I was thinking, maybe you can bring in resources from other theories. Like, for example, you can say that relative to conversations where people presuppose that objects perdure and that you can refer to them at different times, then there is the jure reference. It's only relative to conversations where people have funky metaphysical views that breaks down. And then you can still explain, you know, most of reasoning, dynamic reasoning, just relative to conversations where people have some more metaphysical views.
There is, you still have to believe in this case. If it's
then you get into it.
But it's better, I mean, something you do want to preserve is linking. I think that anti-linking is less.
I mean, anti-linking is. I mean, the one thing to say about anti-linking is that it would be useful to have anti-linking. So Wittgenstein actually, we usually treat variables as they could refer to the same thing. So Wittgenstein actually made it so that x and y have to refer to the same to different things. So that's like the only example of seeing where there's like anti-linking is. But it seems like it'd be very useful to have anti-linking.
Right.
But it just, I just thought it doesn't happen. This is to happen the same way.
Send us a follow-up.
No, the follow-up was just, just shout to
someone.
So that once you, what you introduce, context dependence.
So then Tom might want to say more.
I'm just about the understanding. I mean, and it sounds quite plausible that when you get a name, for the first time, if you understand that sentence with the name in, you can start to have singular thoughts about that she referred to, that kind of thing. I guess I would worry that if that condition is met in the kind of discourse I was talking about, like you mentioned, I was understanding. I mean, would you also deny those understandings of this fragment of the discourse without getting fit? I mean, it starts to be.
I mean, deny understanding in which fragment of the discourse?
Well, just a single sentence. The lights wine, but I know nothing else about. I'm only starting to consider the thoughts. It's like, this is the only time this has ever come up for me. If you understand there, but then you don't understand once you add in the other sentences, possibly non. That seems.
What are the non-core refreshments? This is the case where I'm confused, or
no, it's a case where I'm unsure, but the people who are talking are confused.
It's back to your case where
where
so that's what said you understood this, and then somebody says, Carla, blah blah. So what's your question about that case then?
Listen, if in a case where this would have just been the first sentence called with that,
yeah.
If I understood that, yeah. Which sounds
plausible,
very plausible, yeah. But then you add in these other sentences,
yeah.
Each of which individually I would have understood.
Yeah.
But I don't understand the whole discourse.
Yeah.
That's
right.
Yeah, and that sounds. That's probably to me. I don't have an argument why that's probably the scene.
No, I mean, I think it's intuitive. No, I think, you just take a case of variables, right? So you might, suppose you're doing a math problem, you got x, 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 y. You understand each of them individually, but there's something beyond that. You've got to understand the whole thing, you've got to understand that these kind of, they refer to the same thing. So I think that discourse understanding requires linking relations. Take an Anaphora case, right?
Yeah, that helps. There's discourse understanding and there's
individual understanding.
Okay, fine.
So it's important to the coordination and the relational view that there's more. So there's more to understand the discourse than understand each of the parts. You gotta understand how everything's linked together.
And the test is going to that.
Yes.
That thing. Okay. No. That, yeah.
Yeah. The test is about this.
Okay, unfortunately, we're out of time, you know, there's still people in the least, but we should move on, so we'll see you.